Thank you, Mauro, and thank you for Arif for having me here today. So this is joint work with Taylor Nadal at Brigham Young University and my former colleague Karen Chen, who is back to school at Harvard, who is also here today. And a disclaimer at the bottom is a standard disclaimer that just says that this will be my own views and not those of the Fed more generally. So this paper fits, I think, very well with the general discussion that we had today in terms of the role, the macroeconomic role, and the macroeconomic role of debt. Generally speaking, over the past few years, there has been a significant discussion on the role of credit in affecting prices of assets, both real and financial assets, goods and services. And of course, there has been a lot of emphasis on this question in the context of the housing market, okay? An academic literature that has been definitely spearheaded by the work of Atif and Amir Sufi. From a funding perspective, I would argue that actually housing and post-secondary education have shared many common features. Okay, so we've experienced a very large expansion in loan balances over the past few years in student loans, in student debt, and matching that those increases in balance is also an increase in distress. Similar to the housing market, there is a significant prevalence of the federal government in the United States as originator of these loans. So let me just give you some couple of charts. This plot shows the no mortgage related household liabilities in the US. This is from the New York Fed CCP Equifax panel. And as you can see from the orange line, student debt, you know, despite the fact that there has been a significant deleveraging of different types of forms of household liability post 2008, household debt, student debt has continued its upward trend, and today at about 1.2 trillion is the largest form of household non-mortgage household liability. Okay, in terms of dominance of federal origination in the loan market, this chart is showing you yearly gross total originations from the College Board, which aggregates a variety of data set of data on loans by types of loans. So the orange-like areas are loans to undergraduate students. Those are all federal. The dark blue line is loans to graduate students, and the light blue area are loans that are not under federal programs. And today, about 90% of all student debt in the US is being originated under federal aid programs. So against this backdrop of increasing loan balances, we've, of course, experienced a very large increase in tuition, okay? And here is a chart. So here I'm plotting sticker price, which will be to some extent the focus of my analysis, as the black line against federal debt to undergraduates. And as you can see, there has been this upward trend, and sticker price has increased about 46% from 2001 to 2012, from about $7,000 to $10,000. Okay? So a key policy and, I guess, research question over the past few years has been what's causing the rise in college cost. Actually, this policy debate is not a policy debate that is somewhat new. It was already present in the 80s when the then Secretary of Education, William Bennett, first, for example, tried to discuss the correlation that they were already experiencing in the 80s between federal aid and the cost of college, and tried to provide some causality actually going from aid to the cost of education. This topic is actually it's a very hotly debated topic, both in the presidential campaign in Congress, and there's a number of initiatives. More recently, Congress Research Service report has surveyed the importance of different types of reasons why college may be increasing. So moving, you know, covering, you know, increasing operating costs, you know, faculty at universities, you know, are very kind of a high-skilled job that requires a lot of skills, and we know that those wages have been growing significantly. To other potential explanations, such as declining state appropriation or declining endowments. Okay, The report is also reviewed some of the literature on the impact of federal aid on tuition. Much of this literature focuses on grant, okay? While the paper here, although touching on grant, will be mostly focusing on loans. And we actually presented some of these results in a hearing at the House in October. So in particular, this paper, the question in this paper is, does more borrowing, does more greater availability of student debt lead to higher tuition, okay? It's an obvious question. When you look at the data, there's a standard simultaneity issue. If for other reasons tuition may be trending higher, maybe the other reasons that the Congressional Research Service report pointed out, then students may just be, you know, demanding for more loan just to fund that increasing cost, but this may not be necessarily a causality from additional credit to pricing. The contribution of this paper will be specifically to try to test for the presence of this supply channel, looking at the recent expansion in federal aid programs, which again are a very important source of student debt. Okay, let me just give you a one-page rationale for lending to one student and what that lending may do in aggregate, although some of these points have been touched already earlier today. So there's a clear government economic rationale for government intervention in this market, and the idea generally is that human capital is an intangible good, so investment will be hard to fund for a student because of the lack of collateral. The government can enter into this market and decide single-handedly to just lend without any form of guarantee for public policy, or, you know, has better enforcement technology, for example, imposing non-dischargeability of debt in bankruptcy or by garnishing wages, okay? In equilibrium, however, there's gonna be likely demand effects of this, okay? Take a world where all the students are identical, okay? And suppose that all of the students are at their borrowing constraint, okay? So generally, they're paying less than their willingness to pay. Now, suppose that there's a relaxation of this borrowing constraint because of these additional increases in availability of credit, and this would likely result in a boost in demand, which will affect prices and quantities depending on the elasticities of supply of education services. Okay, it's just a standard tax incidence problem. So a key question here in the education market, you know, which is dominated by public universities, non-profit universities, as well as some for-profits, is, you know, are colleges going to likely, how are they going to accommodate this increase in demand? Okay, so to some extent, you could imagine that access to some universities, which is already rationed because of, you know, very low admission rates, may not be affected, you know, those universities may not be affected that much in their pricing by the greater availability of credit, say, like a very selective school. Other universities, for example, public universities, when they change tuition, they have to go through some processes. For example, public universities have to go through state approval processes. For-profit university, you may think, so the emerging for-profit private sector may be the most likely to accommodate an increase in demand with price increases. And something that turns out to be very useful in general is to look at earnings call for a publicly traded company if you're looking for anecdotes of some information on how they're setting prices or doing things. And here I'm quoting one of the many that we are in the paper, quotes from an earnings call where the CEO of the Apollo Group, which runs, among other things, University of Phoenix, around the policy changes that I'm going to describe next, discusses how clearly they are pricing actually to the borrowing constraint of the student. Okay, so they discuss how an increase in Title IV programs implies this amount, much willingness to ability to pay, and they're just going to match that with an increase in tuition. Okay, the question is to what extent this is going on more broadly. Okay. So here I'm showing you a summary of changes in federal aid policies from the 2000 to 2012. We stop in 2012 because there's a significant change in the graduate program. The subsidized loan program for grad students is eliminated, and as I'll discuss, you know, there's significant, you know, matching some of the conversation that has been in the previous panel, there's significant challenges in measuring actually debt levels for students, even in a country like the US, okay? So in the US, we will be measuring total debt, both for graduates and undergraduates, which is not a great measure, okay? So here I'm showing you a lot of numbers, and I'm gonna highlight a bunch of those. So there's gonna be three pieces of legislation which are going to change what are known as the program maximums. Okay, what is a program maximum? In federal loan programs and in aid programs, there is an individual level constraints. These are generally a function of how much you have to pay, the cost of attendance, and how much you have, the expected family contribution. But irrespective of how much you need, based on that, there's going to be a maximum amount you can borrow. That's the program maximum, okay? So there's a bunch of this legislation that changed this program maximum over the past few years. So the first one is the Higher Education Reconciliation 2006 Act, which changed the subsidized loan limits. Again, a subsidized federal loan program is different than an unsubsidized because it pays interest while a student is in school. Moved that cap from 2625 to 3500, so that's the highlighted numbers, and from 3500 to 4500 for sophomores, okay? So those were actually the first increases since the early 1990s, so significant changes. Then the Ensuring Continuing Access to Student Loans 2008 Act changed the maximum amount for unsubsidized loans by $2,000 for all types of students, both dependent and independent. And then, although our focus is not very much about Pell Grants, there's a number of changes in the caps for Pell Grants over these years, and we will have to control for those. Okay, these are more gradual, so I'm highlighting essentially the whole column, because in part Pell Grants amounts are changed not through federal legislation, but through the yearly appropriation process, so they are much more smooth, okay? So here is what we observe in terms of aid amounts over these years of significant changes. And based on this chart, I will argue that these are very large changes. It's a very large shock to the availability of aid to students. Okay, so here in the black line, you see the jump in federal student loan aid, and the orange line is Pell Grant amounts. Okay. More specifically for the loan program, here I'm separating loan balances per student for subsidized loans and unsubsidized loans. And not only you're seeing this general increase around those years, but they actually, there are discrete jumps that match the exact years in which these caps are being increased, okay? So the subsidized loan program has the increase happening the year before. You see the jump there, and the unsubsidized the year afterwards, okay? In the paper, we'll also show some evidence based on detailed data on the distribution of loan amounts from Equifax data. Okay, so great, you got like a big aggregate shock, so what are you gonna do in terms of identification? Okay, so generally speaking, this is an aggregate shock, so this is not gonna be great for identification. I'm not gonna argue that all the increase in 2008 will come from this increase in aid, especially over those years. By the way, when I say 2008 is the year, the calendar year ending in 2008. However, despite the fact that these are aggregate changes, how they apply to different universities varies significantly, okay? And this is essentially because of the individual level constraints, meaning that in some universities, students may apply for aid and in other ones may not, okay? So what we will do is to try to see, to look at like institution-specific shocks, is to try to construct exposures at the level of an institution, which essentially tell you how many students are likely to be receiving this additional aid over that year, and we measure that ex ante. Okay, so we're gonna construct two BARTIC-like measures, actually three, two for loans and one for Pell Grants. These are very simple. The dollar loan cap is the change in those amounts that we saw in the previous table, and these exposures, those vary only in the time series, and then the exposure is just basically a cross-sectional measure that tells you how many students will be affected a priori, we expect to be affected a priori by these policies, okay? So for the loan amounts is the people at the caps, and then for Pell Grants, just because the whole schedule is shifting up, it's any positive amount, okay? So the key is where do you get this exposure measure? So we got data from the Department of Education, the restricted use NIPSAS data, which every 4 years samples has great information in terms of financials of the student population. The problem with this data, it only comes every 4 years, okay? So we're gonna use, I'm gonna sort essentially universities based on their exposure to these policies as of 2004, because it's predating all our policy. We also do it as of 2008 in the paper, okay? And then I'm using different data, other sources to measure sticker tuition. I'll explain why sticker and not net tuition. that is net of grant and institutional grants. And then we use Title IV data for loan amounts. IPEDS data, which is one of the main data sets that carries information about institutions, also has information about loan amounts, but those are survey-based. So these are not actual disbursed amount. We prefer to use the Title IV, which are great. However, they aggregate both graduate and undergraduate students over our sample. Okay, so before going into the actual results, there are two possible variables of interest you may be thinking of at this point. First of all is the response of tuition to these changes in the caps, or the interaction between the cap and the exposure. These caps are the policy variable of interest. This is what is under the control of Congress. Okay. The coefficient is also of economic significance because it will tell you, for example, for loan amounts, what is the elasticity or sensitivity of prices to a relaxation of the borrowing constraint, okay? A second sensitivity you may be interested in is to try to instrument actual aid amounts by this exposure measure. This is a pure Bartik-like instrument regression. This is very, it's more potentially meaningful, reflects also the elasticity of demand of this aid, but as I said before, we face challenges in measuring loan amounts with precision, okay? So we're mostly focusing on one, although we're also going to show results for two. That said, if aid elasticity is for someone at caps is very high, the results will be very similar because aid will be going up one for one with the amounts that are available to students, okay? So this is our baseline regression results. Columns 1 through 3 is regressing Pell Grant subsidized loan amounts per student and unsubsidized loan amounts per student at institution I over period T. This is yearly data. And then the fourth regression is the reduced form IV with respect to sticker price. Okay? And again, the explanatory variables, it's this interaction between exposure and changes in amount of aid. So first of all, if you look through the diagonal terms in columns 1 through 3, you see that there is a very high sensitivity of aid amounts to this instrumented or to this institution-specific cap levels, which vary from about 1, this is not significantly different than 1, 1.1 for Pell Grants, to about 0.7 for subsidized loans and 0.56 for unsubsidized loans. Then scrolling on the first row over the first three columns, you also see some negative signs of Pell Grants on other forms of aid, and this is essentially a substitution effect, meaning that the more Pell Grants that you have, the less lending there will be or borrowing. Okay? And the fourth column, which is the most interesting for us in this paper, looks at the sensitivity of sticker price to a dollar going to the representative student to that university, and you see very large estimates. So for example, for the subsidized loan program, a dollar increase in this amount of aid available based on these cross-sectional effects leads to a 60 cents increase in tuition, which is huge if you think about it. By the way, this regression includes institutions and year fixed effects, so we're basically just identifying off that cross-section in that year. Okay, you also see similar large effects, fairly large effects for Pell Grants in the order of 35 cents on the dollar and unsubsidized loans about 15 cents on the dollar. Okay, so here, this is the instrumented variable regression. So just looking at column 4, we're getting estimates that are very similar, somewhat larger, but in orders of magnitude similar. So for example, we said before about 60 cents on the dollar for subsidized loans, here it's 75 cents. And the reason why these are very similar is because of those diagonal terms in the previous regression that come out kind of close to one, okay? The paper is mostly focusing on sticker price. Sticker price is not what you want as a researcher, but is what you measure as a researcher, okay? Measures of institutional grants are much more noisy and they're available for much fewer institutions. In this case, we're looking at the finance service from IPEDS, which reports expenditure on institutional grants to undergraduate and graduates every year, okay? We divide this by enrollment. We only get about half of the sample, but the punchline is that even if you run it in this shorter sample, you do see additional effects going into institutional grants on some substitution of institutional grants with respect to federal aids on top of what we have seen with sticker price. So for example, an increase in Pell Grants amount also leads to a decline in institutional grants, so institutions give less grants when more Pell Grants are available. And also you see some effects for subsidized loans. This is column 1. And then we construct a measure of net tuition is the column 2. Let me jump to 3. 3, we're looking at the change in enrollments. And the results, the punchline of those results is that the enrollment effects kind of line up to degree of subsidy embedded in each form of aid. For Pell grants, it's a pure disbursement. Okay, to the extent that you don't see a pass-through effect that is greater than one, this is a student receiving money to go to college, and that will increase demand, and it will be more students will go. Okay, so you see column three, row one, you see a positive effect. Unsubsidized loans, you're relaxing the borrowing constraint. However, the net cost of going to college is also actually increasing, and you're seeing somewhat of a negative effect. And subsidized loan, it's not significant, it's somewhere in between. Okay, so robustness checks. There's a lot of things you may worry about that are going wrong in this regression. We try a couple of things. Let me just show you a couple. Okay? So first of all, adding additional control. So the first thing you may worry about is, well, I'm using this data set that are private, not for-profit, profit. To what extent is this just driven by for-profit universities, like the quote that we saw before? Okay, that may be interesting as a paper, but not much of a puzzle based on the quotes that I pulled out before. Column one is basically trying to control for that. We have fixed effects, so we know which universities are for-profit or not, but the question is, did those for-profit universities increase their tuition in an unusual way for other reasons in those exact years, and to what extent this is driving the result? So we need to interact this cross-sectional being a for-profit with the actual changes in caps, and there we have three of those. So that's the first column, and essentially the results are not much different, but this is not magic. It's just because we don't have many for-profits in our sample. Okay, the second column is a much harder test for the model, and essentially here's the key issue: the fraction of students at these caps are a function of the cost of attending college and the expected family contribution that you're observing. Okay. You may worry that students in certain university may be behaving differently, or those university may be behaving differently in those years. When we add those control, this is, I would say, it's a very hard test because we are controlling for stuff that enters into our selection equation on average. We only see that the subsidized loan effect survives and is significant. Okay. The other ones do not. And so this could be a fact that we had omitted variables, or it could be that the subsidized loan exposure is measured much more precisely. For example, for Pell amounts, it grows, the fraction of students that are receiving any positive amount grows linearly with the expected family contribution, but for subsidized loans, it's an exact point in the distribution because we're measuring precisely, okay? Column three, we are throwing additional controls for other sources of revenues. This is going back to the Congressional Service study. And we see that while those enter the regression, they do not affect the results. Another key question is, how would have this university behaved, the exposed and less exposed ones, in university in years other than the ones that where we have observed policy changes? So here we're doing a simple placebo effect where, rather than interacting this exposure variable with the actual cap change, we just regress it every year and try to see the time series variation in this coefficient psi. Okay, this is, for the other years, this is going to be a placebo effect. We're trying to see that cross-sectional coefficient in the other years. And for subsidized loans, we see generally positive results in the sense that they pass the placebo effect. Here, the left-out category is 2006, so it's all relative to that year. And you see that the unusual increase in subsidized loans happens only in the year of policy change, which is the gray bar, and also in terms of sticker price. For other forms of aid, we don't see such strong effects as well, okay? So that's kind of a common theme. We have some additional results, which just try to disentangle the result across different types of characteristics of schools, as well as looking at additional information for-profits that are underrepresented. But more generally, I think the more interesting result, although much less well-identified, more of a Levin regression of the 90s, is the pre-policy trend. So we are looking at these policy effects, and we're trying to find evidence that there is a pass-through effects, okay? But you know, we've seen the sticker price increasing throughout the 2000s. There were no changes in caps. Okay, so caps cannot explain all that trend. However, this doesn't mean that federal aid did not play any role. It could have been, for example, just that the existence of those programs may have allowed university to expand their enrollment and this increase in and partially also affect tuition. We do that just by looking at sorting university ex ante as of 2002 based on their reliance on aid, and then looking at five-year patterns afterwards, and we find some results that suggest that more dependent university, more aid-dependent universities also grew their tuition relatively more. They had, but also had a significant expansion in enrollments. Okay, so just in conclusion, we studied the response of tuition to fellow student aid. We generally find evidence supporting the Bennett hypothesis around the changes in policy that we have observed over the past few years. In particular, there's abnormal tuition increases for universities where the student population is most likely to receive this form of aid. The effect is particularly strong for subsidized loans, but the results are not as strong for Pell Grants. And then just in terms of benefit incidence, in the short run here, we're seeing actually a detrimental effect of this increase in aid, especially for the loan program. The average student is receiving this additional lending, but then all this increased capacity to spend is being essentially appropriated by the university. In the long run, however, the benefits may be different, and especially we're also showing this increases in enrollment, and those could be important policy goals.
All right, so if you're wondering if we should be talking about student loans at a public policy and finance conference, the answer is yes, 1,000 times yes. It should be a slam dunk case for the importance. We've seen the graph that it's the second highest category, so the highest category of consumer debt outside of mortgages and fastest growing. So we have that. We have lots of rumblings in the press lately about the evils of student debt. In some of the data I've looked at, I actually see a U-shaped relationship with age. I see people that I wouldn't necessarily expect to have student debt, and they're carrying student debt from sending their kids through school. So it's not just kind of the millennials that are suffering under student debt and perhaps living in their parents' basement and not getting married and not owning homes. So it's also on other ends of the age spectrum. And then clearly there's been a national debate lately about tuition prices. As a faculty member of the University of California system, this is something we're acutely thinking about lately with our troubling finances. So the motivation is clear, and it comes from this idea of, look, government public policy intervenes in financial markets, in particular credit markets, all the time. We want to understand the consequences of that. Let me take a moment and provide an alternate motivation for this, a framework that I think will be useful, thinking about first principles. So if you haven't drawn supply and demand graphs for a little while, I'm going to walk you through it. So the idea here is that there are lots of externalities in the world, positive externalities, for example, that the government corrects through subsidies. So you can debate the size of the externality, but the justification for a lot of such subsidies are externality. So I'm thinking of the mortgage interest tax deductibility, rent vouchers, fuel-efficient cars, health insurance, and many other examples. So whether or not these subsidies are effective depends crucially on the degree to which they pass through onto prices. So if demand was perfectly inelastic, you shouldn't expect the subsidy to be able to move the needle on actually inducing more quantity at all. And in fact, you can see that all of that would be captured and passed through into prices. So we are going to see a subsidy for higher education. I'm going to show you a supply and demand graph as if we're going from a world of no subsidy to subsidy. And in fact, we're tweaking the subsidy a little bit. And let's oversimplify it for the sake of argument. And let's see what happens. OK, so here's our supply and demand graph. We have a private benefit that is how people make their decisions. They make their decision on how much education to achieve or whether or not they themselves become educated by comparing private benefits and private costs. However, there's a social benefit. The difference between that social benefit and the private benefit is the size of the externality. And so in a perfect world, we would like to be able to do the efficient thing, which is move from the competitive equilibrium to the socially efficient equilibrium where social benefits are equated to private costs. Okay. So how do we do that? We can do that by enacting a subsidy. So what that would do is it would effectively shift the cost curve down. So the cost curve that the individual faces for a given level of education is lower. So that's the amount of the subsidy. And when the individual now optimizes against this subsidized cost curve, more people become educated. We induce more education, more in line with what the social benefits are. So what happens to prices? You can see two things. Net of the subsidy, clearly prices have gone down. So I can call this the user cost of attending school or of getting educated. So prices go up. You can see that as the sticker cost because of this demand elasticity, if you will. I'm going to move farther along to the right, and so the private cost is going to be higher. So think of that as the sticker price, the pre-subsidy price. You could call that the net tuition as well. It doesn't really make a difference. And the idea here is we would always expect a subsidy to raise sticker prices, to raise kind of the gross excluding the subsidy price. Now, net of the subsidy, we're going to have lower prices because they're subsidized. We never expect prices to fall by the entire amount of the subsidy purely because of this demand response, right? Okay, so let me make sure that I've covered everything that I wanted to say on that. You can imagine this with Pell Grants quite easily. I'm literally giving you a subsidy, but even a subsidized loan is a subsidy. So there's two ways to think about it. One is relative to the private option that I had before, the private market option that I had before. I'm receiving a subsidized cost of attending school. And in particular, there could be these marginalized students that were not receiving education pre-expansion of subsidies and now are able to. And so the user cost change for them is a little bit trickier to understand and probably much larger. Okay, so we've talked about the Bennett hypothesis from Dr. Bennett, Secretary Bennett. And so what do economics first principles have to say about this hypothesis that one of the reasons for the increase in tuition over time is the existence of this subsidy? Yeah, that makes sense. We can see that that would happen. All right, so what this paper is going to do is measure this delta P term. Here's the amount of the subsidy. Some amount of it is captured by schools. Some amount of it is passed through onto to students. And this paper is going to measure that change in prices. So is that change in posted prices before the subsidy, is that a relevant policy parameter? Absolutely. There are dozens of reasons why we should clearly care about this. In particular, in real life, we don't really know where Q star is. We have papers that try to tell us the size of the externality, and we have papers that maybe try to estimate these elasticities, but there's a lot of uncertainty here, and it's not a simple two-dimensional representation like I've put it up here to figure out exactly where Q star is and thus what the optimal subsidy is. So knowing the amount of the pass-through is a function of the difference between the demand and the supply elasticity. It's a function of the size of the subsidy, and so this tells us a lot that we care about. But just intuitively, if I'm going to subsidize a good and we the people are subsidizing higher education, I would like to know what the pass-through of that is going to be onto prices. Then there's lots in the paper as well about heterogeneity and distributional impacts. Those are all very relevant and justify us looking at delta P. All right, so the paper in a nutshell, yes, there is a pass-through of student aid onto federal student aid onto tuition prices. And the way the paper works, if you've already forgotten from 15 minutes ago when we just saw it, is that caps on loan sizes and grants increased from 2008 to 2010. And this is going to disproportionately affect those schools that have a higher fraction of their student body at those caps, right? So those caps matter more for certain schools. This gives us some nice cross-sectional heterogeneity that has a nice empirical prediction. So how do we understand what the magnitudes are? I'm going to interpret the magnitudes on this interaction term a little bit differently. I think this is an important point. What the magnitudes are saying is for every $1 increase in the available subsidized funding, tuition rises by 50 cents. Essentially, can't reject 50 cents, so we'll use that to make the math easy. Multiplied by the fraction of students at that school that were at the loan cap. So this is an interaction term. It's all modulated by that. Okay, so if I take the mean exposure to this, the average school has 15% of their students maxing out on the subsidized loan caps. So what does that mean? The effect of the change in loan caps would be for that typical school, it would be that 50 cents on the dollar pass-through times $1,000 times 15% of the student body to get this interaction term right. And so what that would be is for the typical school, tuition is going up by $75. All right, so what are the virtues of this paper now that we've described it? So it's undisputably an important topic. It has this nice economics 101 intuition to it that we would expect from first principles. It also is clearly relevant to our theme of public policy and finance. Plausibly exogenous variation that I find credible, especially because of the rocking event study that they have in their paper, and that David didn't have a lot of time to brag about. But if you look at that event study, it's very compelling to validate this using this cross-sectional variation. And then, of course, it has these smoking gun quotes from for-profit schools admitting that they actually raise tuition in direct response, in part, to changes in federal aid. So I have just a few brief comments. So one is that because we can't observe that user cost, it's hard to say that in the short run these higher loan caps can be costly to students in aggregate, which is a claim that I think is in there. The paper is incredibly careful, but that claim is in there. So if we think that 20% of students at a school are getting a subsidy of $1,000, and all of the students at that school are facing a $100 increase in tuition, on aggregate, the student body is benefiting by $100 a person. The treated students that are receiving the subsidy, they're benefiting by $900 a student, but it's clear that the majority of the students who are not receiving the subsidy, the modal student, they're losing $100. But if you want to make a claim that the aggregate student is being actually, there's this backfiring effect, I would say, well, the effect of the subsidy is mitigated by the fact that tuition is increasing, but I wouldn't say that it's a negative effect, partly because we don't know what the effects on that user cost are, and partly because we don't expect it to be that direction based on first principles. All right. Then the last substantive point that I'll make is, so in general, we have small effects. If you think of a two standard deviation change here is in the exposure variable is increasing tuition by $150. It's somewhat remarkable that we have such precision to be able to estimate that with somewhere around 1.5% increase in tuition. So we have statistical significance in the paper, and especially for subsidized student loans, they seem very robust, and the coefficient doesn't move much no matter what controls are thrown at it. So I wonder a little bit about the data generating process, and if the aggregation that's happening in the first stage to calculate these variables is masking some important heterogeneity. So you could think of this as just measurement error, but the way NIPSAS works is there's between zero and hundreds of students that are sampled for each school. Using that microdata, you absolutely have to have this microdata to be able to do this exercise. This authors are then able to calculate the fraction that are at a given cap. And so the average school has plenty of students to be able to accurately estimate this. But there's undoubtedly schools in there, and the paper doesn't report the distribution, that have very small numbers of students for which this variable is being calculated. So if that's just if you just think about that as measurement error, then you would just say, okay, well, great, then their coefficients are a lower bound on what you would really want. However, it could be overstating the precision of their estimates if there's a lot of variability in there. So there's a simple bootstrap procedure you could do, similar to what you would do with a generated regressor, where you would sample the students with a replacement, calculate the new exposure variables, and then run the second stage on your new bootstrap sample. So let me say just a couple next steps. I'm still in search. I have bugged them a little bit about their efforts to say, can we extrapolate, kind of tie over the shoulder identification to the pre-period where we don't have this nice natural experiment and understand how much of the rise in tuition over the last decade or two decades or so has been driven by federal aid, and they've done a yeoman's job of that. I'm still looking for a figure that tells me how much of the increase in tuition over the past, say, decade is because of a change in loan supply. And similarly, how much has that contributed to aggregate outstanding student debt? So when I think about the Congressional Research Service report that says here are some of the reasons tuition's gone up, and I think about the Bennett hypothesis, we now have empirical confirmation for the Bennett hypothesis. I want to know where it falls on the family feud list. Is it number 3 of 5? Is it number 1? Is it kind of a footnote? I'd love to know that relative importance of that to give me a headline number that I can remember and kind of justify telling people that, like, this is really a major thing. If you're writing your New York Times article about tuitions running away, you can't leave out student loan debt. I'm still looking for that number to justify that. Every paper that looks partially at a cost is going to have a discussion that says, you know, you should really think about welfare, and of course there are a lot of inputs that go into that. One of them would be a calibrated user cost model of higher education attainment to understand, okay, what is the value of that subsidy to my user cost, and so then I understand a little bit one side of the welfare equation. And then also, if you have heterogeneity in school expenditures, which for a lot of schools you don't, but perhaps for some of them you do, and maybe in particular for public schools, and I don't know if the 10Ks of for-profits have it separated out by expenditure, but it'd be fascinating to know where these tuition increases are showing up. So where is this money sticking? I can imagine a variety of places. All right, so in conclusion, let me sum up the paper and my comments in 6 points. So we, the people of the United States of America, as taxpayers, subsidize lots of things, including higher education. From first principles, from economics, you would expect this to raise prices and lower user costs, so prices minus the subsidy. The amount by which it raises prices is very important, and we have great evidence for that amount in this paper. It does raise prices. Typical student tuition for the mean school went up by $75 a year because of the cap increases. Credit supply shocks do show up in asset prices. That shouldn't seem surprising, and yet there's been people that want to push back in the policy sphere every time this is suggested, that intervening and subsidizing any kind of lending is going to actually have an effect on prices. So again, we have confirmation of that. And I think there is more to be done thinking about the aggregate implications of the magnitudes. How do I aggregate this up? Exactly what does it mean? Is it good or bad in a partial equilibrium sense? And then perhaps some extra work on the inference. Thank you.
Yeah, on your split sample that you noticed a couple slides back on David's paper, he's talking about the more expensive schools that the loan effect is actually exacerbated. And I guess I find that somewhat surprising, because I know at least with the Ivy League schools, most of the Ivy League schools, their financial aid departments, because of their large endowments, have made pledges that they'll increase the institutional grants to students so students do not have to take student loans if they're accepted and decide to attend. I know Princeton has that policy, Penn has that policy, Harvard, Yale. So I don't know if you studied, it would be interesting to study a split sample of the effects with respect to Ivy League schools, because they have tried to minimize the effect of student loans and the burden on their students. Have you looked at that at all?
So partly is the size of the sample. I mean, if you look at the distribution of tuition, I completely agree with your priors that, you know, you wouldn't expect an Ivy League. I mean, this was to some extent, you know, my ex ante question, you know, should a university which is already rationing massively admission be affected at all by an increase in demand? So if you look at the distribution of tuition, there's a large number of universities that have relatively high tuition that price as high as an Ivy League. They're not necessarily Ivy League. In the sample, if you start cutting down on admission rates, so you have to go to very, very low admission rates to end up into an Ivy League, you kind of end up with very, very few universities. I haven't literally looked at Ivy Leagues. I would just say that the high tuition level does not just imply an Ivy League, right, but just like a relatively expensive, including University of Phoenix, private university, for example.
Okay.
Yes.
Place where the subsidy can be dissipated. You did mention the fact that states have been cutting their support of their state university systems, and it seems to me you could look at the extent to which the same effects on the loan programs have encouraged state legislators to say, well, the federal government's putting up the money, we don't have to anymore, and dissipating the subsidy in that way.
Yes, so what we have done here is not to rule out state funding. Actually, you know, in that regression that I show quickly comes in with the right sign. So it does matter the fact that funding is declining. The results we are seeing is on top of that. I mean, generally speaking, I think there are different ways of funding post-secondary education. If you go back in Europe, for example, it's mostly funded through government through direct funding from governments. In the U.S., the system was a little bit different, with state university being funded by states, and you know, than private university being funded separately. And now the model is changing to some extent, and I think it's moving the burden of it, of paying education from states back into the students' pockets. So we do find results also within public universities. Have I found a quote of a legislator that says Title IV programs are increasing, let me increase it? I don't think any politician would ever say something like that, as opposed to a CEO talking their book to an earning analyst. But it's definitely a possibility. Yeah. Maybe I can respond to Chris's comments, and then maybe we'll go back to questions if there are any. So first of all, thank you very much for your thoughtful comments. So I think that in terms of the worse-off effect, what we think about is mainly the loan program. The subsidy, it is a subsidy. I haven't done actually a lot of research in economics of education, but I just think of the subsidy as something that incentivizes students to take those loans because, it's free, so to speak. I mean, but it's increasing your borrowing capacity as a whole. But the main subsidy where we're thinking of the worse-off effect is not for something like Pell Grants, where, unless you're basically increasing tuition more than one-for-one, is very much about loans. The subsidizing of the loan is not that large because it's just the interest, which is already fairly low. And so if sticker price is going up, it's through your borrowing capacity is going up significantly. That is not really helping you that much. This is for a student who is already at school, okay? Not a student, a prospective student who may be able to join. That's a different effect, the expansion. But that student will be made worse off in the short run. This is just the representative student. It doesn't take into account any heterogeneity, access to education, et cetera. I think the bootstrap suggestion is very good. In terms of the, and we'll work on it, in terms of the big question, rather than, going into very high identification and, effects around the program change versus the trend, that's something we don't cite at all in the paper. You can take your point estimates and just splice them back to the aggregate change. I try not to ever do it in a paper, although I'm sure I'll have to do it at the end in the conclusion. 50 cents increase in something that's double, it will be huge. But, who am I to say that those are the appropriate estimates? I don't know. Those are local estimates. It's always complicated. But just in terms of order of magnitude, Cellini and Goldin have an interesting paper where, has less of an identification, but is more about what does the existence of this Title IV program do to sticker tuition, okay? So what they do is that they look at, compare private universities for profits and private university for profits that are not eligible for Title IV programs. And, there's obviously composition effects, and they try to account for that, and you're never going to be able to do it convincingly, to some extent. They find differences in the order of 75%. Okay, so it's massive, at least for that sector. So more generally, maybe smaller, but that's kind of the order of magnitude. Seems to be very large. Our paper currently does not imply anything in terms of that.
One last question, if there's anything from the floor.
I guess with your delta P with the pass-through effect, you had approximated about 58 cents, so that means 42 cents roughly, or 42%, is a benefit back to the student. Once it tilts past 50% on the pass-through, in effect, the institution is capturing more of the benefit than the person that you're trying to benefit. Are you looking at any innovative ways, either with the Fed working with the federal government, with higher education, to look at ways to tilt that curve to where the pass-through becomes less than 50%, so the student is actually benefiting more than the institution?
Well, so actually, the effects for loans is worse than that calculation, because in terms of a loan, you always are responsible for repaying back the principal. So it is actually your considering that that student would have gone at that university anyway, which is like an assumption here, the student is made 50 cents worse off by that policy because of the aggregate boost in demand. In terms of policy, the answer is no. That's not something I actually do actively. Generally speaking, I think, as Chris was saying, it's a tax incidence problem. And whenever you have a benefit, and this is a particular benefit because it's in a form of a relaxed borrowing constraint, so there isn't a direct disbursement to the student, you're always going to find the price effect, and so it's a question of how you're trading things off. I think earlier today we heard interesting ways in which potentially lenders can also be made accountable for the loans they're making in terms of sharing and holding an equity tranche into the student's future income potential. And there's also potential legislation on actually making the schools responsible. And I think those would be valuable legislations, but I haven't done anything in particular.